Good morning. Welcome to St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church in Stittsville on this Remembrance Sunday. Also, a warm welcome to anyone who's joining us on the live stream and the YouTube videos afterwards. It's great to be together for worship in ways we can in this new era. A reminder that with the new protocols, you are welcome to sit. You don't have to keep 6 feet separation, but we do still encourage it where possible. We're using every second pew along now. For the time being, and we will encourage you at the end of the service, if you're able, to come out through these doors here and out onto the church lawn, and we can gather there for a bit of visiting time after the service. So we'll try not to go back through the gathering space to go out, but having said that, during the service, if you need washrooms or anything, feel free to make use of the facilities. As we gather for worship today, I invite Katie to come forward to do our call to worship. I invite you to stand and join in the responses.
On this day where the guns once fell silent,
we come before you, God, seeking your peace.
On this day of hope in the face of terror,
we come before you, God, praying with all our hearts that let there be peace on earth.
And let it begin with us.
Let us worship the Lord our God and the Prince of Peace.
Let's remain standing for our opening hymn, For All the Saints. And as usual, I invite you to mumble along as we enjoy this hymn and try not to sing out.
Thank you.
Let's come before God in prayer. Let us pray. God of love, on this Remembrance Day Sunday, we take a moment to remember, to lift up to you in prayer all those who have served in wars years ago, and those who continue to serve in other nations today. We know you as the God of peace, and yet our nations continue to fight against each other, and different factions within nations are at odds. Help those in positions of power to work towards peace, and those who are powerless to be kept safe and secure. We also remember those among us who have experienced the loss and the suffering of war and have experienced service. At this time, as they're filled with memories of difficult times, of battles that were fought, of friends and loved ones that were lost, we lift them up to you in care and support, O God. Help us to never forget the past and to work towards a better future filled with your peace and your love. We ask this in Jesus' name and pray with his familiar words, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hear the good news of the gospel that is shared with us over and over again. God loves you a lot, so love one another. It's a gift given to us. It's a gift that we have to share. God sends us out into the world to share what we have found, and for that we give thanks. Amen. It's a bit of a different Remembrance Day. You may remember last year we had everything online. This year it's difficult to have the bringing forward of the wreath and the closeness. So what we've done is put together the act of remembrance from last year combined with me coming down to read the names. And so I will invite you, if you're able, to stand for the act of remembrance now. Albert Bradley, Milton Brown, Lindsay Brown, Wallace Caldwell, Harold Houston, Philip Ilott, Hugh Murray, Allison Murray, John Potter, Donald McCooey, Hubert Paul, John Stitt, Cecil Sample, Eldon Sample, Robert Sample, Ernest Sample, Lewis Wilkins, and Arthur Sample.
They shall not grow old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember. We will remember.
Thank you.
So great celebrations. I'm going to ask you two a question. Do you know what kind of plant this is? Have you ever seen a plant like this before? You have, but you don't know what kind it is? Yeah, I understand. Do you see all the flowers on it? Right now it has, can you count how many can you see from there? How many flowers have we got on it right now? There's one. We can count in French too if you want. Nope. One, two, three, four, five. At least five. Oh, six. One hiding down there as well. We got lots of flowers. Does anyone else know what kind of plant this is? A peace lily. That's right. So this is called a peace lily. Yeah. And we actually, we bought peace lilies for us and for two other groups, for two other Muslim associations, and gave them peace lilies. And I was thinking it's great that as we celebrate Remembrance Day and we think about peace, and Remembrance Day we often think about war as well, and we have the poppies that remind us of that as well, but we also think about peace and praying for peace. So I think it's wonderful that our peace lily is blooming as we celebrate Remembrance Sunday. And we think about peace in our world and peace all over between all different peoples. Let's have a prayer together, and then you can go back and sit with your families. And everyone can respond, if you like, with the prayer. Let us pray. Dear God, we pray for peace. We give you thanks for our world we have. Help us to reach out and be channels of your peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. See you guys.
Our responsive psalm this morning, you're going to see up on the screen in just a moment. And one of the people during Bible study this week noted that this is often a psalm that's done antiphonally. It'd be, if in ancient Israel, they might have, in the temple, had two different groups of people saying it back and forth to each other. So thanks to that person in Bible study, we're going to do this antiphonally. So I invite you to stand, and you'll notice as it comes up on the screen that there's times when it says north and it says south. So you're the north side of the sanctuary. You're the south side of the sanctuary. I'll be the leader, and we'll all be the congregation. So let's join together in our responsive psalm. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it. For he has founded it on the sea and established it on the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in his holy place? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of Glory may come in.
Who is the King of Glory? The Lord is strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is this King of Glory?
The Lord of hosts. He is the King of Glory.
Thank you very much. You may be seated. And in a moment, Muriel will come forward to do the scripture readings, and I'll just clean the pulpit again.
That's easier. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-matured wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-matured wines strained clearly. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all of the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord of whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The next one is from Revelation 21, verses 1 to 5. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of the heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell within them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new.
May God add wisdom to these readings from the Word. Let's come before God in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, may the words of my mouth, the thoughts and the meditations of all of our hearts, may they be acceptable to you, our God and our guide. Amen. As we begin this Remembrance Day service, I'm reminded that Remembrance Day in many ways reminds me of funeral services. And funeral service in the Presbyterian Church in Canada often begins with, dear friends, we are united today by a common sorrow, by a common affection, and a common hope. We have come together to give thanks for the life of our friends, to remember the ways their lives touched ours, and to give thanks for the keeping of Almighty God. We're also here to bear witness to our hope in Jesus Christ, who said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me will never die. A common sorrow, a common affection, and a common hope. Those are familiar words to us. They come from the Book of Common Worship for the Presbyterian Church in Canada, and they're words often said at funerals, as I said. I've used those words many times as I've stood in front of a family in the congregation, celebrating the life of someone who has died, and also being present with them as they come to terms with their loss. Those are the words I use this morning to introduce the sermon, because it is, on Remembrance Day, quite similar to a funeral or memorial service. We gather with a common sorrow. We gather with a common affection and with a common hope. The common sorrow. Some of you may not like the idea of common sorrow, because many people don't want a funeral to be a sad time, a time of crying and a time of weeping. You know, almost every funeral service I've conducted, as I was planning the funeral with the family, many of them have said, almost all of them have said, we don't want it to be a sad time. They say they don't want their family member would not have wanted them to be sitting around crying at the funeral service. And as much as that may be true, sorrow is also an important part of saying goodbye, an important part of the grief process. It's an important part of moving on with life. It's an important part of Remembrance Day as well. For many, especially for veterans, it's impossible to remember without also being sad. Sorrow for lives lost, for friends and family members who never had the opportunity to have a long life, to raise children, to know the joy of holding their first grandchild. Remembrance Day, we have to acknowledge, is a sad day
for many people. There will be tears shed in memory of those no longer with us, and tears shed in sympathy by those who never knew those people, but share in the sorrow of those who mourn. On Remembrance Day, it is our job to share the sorrow. It's a common affection as well. Funeral services and Remembrance Day are not just about sorrow. They're also about remembering good times, a common affection held for someone who's no longer with us. It is a time for those who remember the war to sit around and to reminisce as well, and remember the good times shared with comrades and friends, a time to recount stories and share stories of what life was like for them back then, to remember the affection they held for those who are gone. I've found this, you may have found this as well, in talking to people who served in the war. When I used to ask my grandfather about his experiences from the war, he rarely wanted to talk about battles and fights and things that went on and death. He wanted to talk about some of the good times, about fellow soldiers, how he became close to these people and how they became such good friends. Stories about close as it comes when you trust someone with your life. Whether it was in world wars or military and peacekeeping missions around the world since then. There are always stories about the common affection shared between friends. A common sorrow, a common affection, and a common hope. The last part of the phrase is of great importance on Remembrance Day, a common hope. Ideally, in a funeral service, there is a flow to the service. The service begins with remembering the past, the life of the person who has died, memories of things that we are thankful for. Then there's a very clear acknowledgement in the funeral service that the person has died. I will often, at that point in the funeral service, in one sentence, be very specific about how the person died, whether it was because of cancer, or stroke, or a sudden heart attack, or just the gradual process of old age. It's important to acknowledge that death is real. It's often difficult at a funeral service to talk about death in real terms, though, because so many people try to avoid it. We try to soften the reality of death, and without the reality of the death, it's hard to move on to hope. We talk about death in metaphorical terms so often. We talk about the person passing on or passing away. We say the person is no longer with us, or they've been taken home. You've probably also heard terms like promoted to glory, gone to be with God. In so many ways, trying to soften the reality that the person has died. There's nothing wrong with using these terms from time to time, but I think it's only when we acknowledge the fact of death that we begin to move on to hope. As followers of Jesus, death is not something to fear. It's a natural part of life. It's in accepting the reality of death and the assurance that the physical world is not the only existence we believe in, that we can live life more fully now. It's similar with Remembrance Day, I think, for many of us. We don't want to confront every year over and over again the reality of war and the death that comes with it. In some ways, people of my age would prefer to relegate Remembrance Day to only the memories of the First and Second World War. That would make it easier for us because that would take away the responsibility of what's going on in the world right now. We don't want to think about all the people who are serving and dying in wars and conflicts that continue on today. The ongoing battles, the atrocities in Afghanistan as we watch the withdrawal and as we see what's happening since. Images that are still coming out of Syria, even though it's not in the news so much. The battles we're hearing about and seeing in Ethiopia right now. And yet, when we relegate Remembrance Day just to the wars of the past, then we miss the main point of why it is we remember. Remembrance Day is not just about the wars that happened long ago. It is about what's happening in the world today. And it's about committing ourselves to preventing the wars of the future and working towards peace today. War is not something of the past, it is a present reality in many people's lives. And it could be part of the future. And that's part of why we have to remember even the bad things that happen in war. A common hope should be that it might be possible to have a future, to have peace, so that children today will not have to go through what their great-grandparents went through. Hope comes in the funeral service when we look at life and death through the lens of Scripture. We look at our lives through the lens of Scripture, we're able to see that dark times don't last because it gives us a longer perspective. The common hope we celebrate on Remembrance Day is the common hope of resurrection, the common hope of future. We remember the past, and then we're less likely to repeat it. The Scriptures that we have today, the lens through which we see our lives on this Remembrance Day, is a passage from Isaiah 25, the hope of a banquet to come that God will prepare for all people. You know, when this passage of Scripture was written in ancient Israel, they were in the middle of a very difficult time. They were being attacked by powerful nations. They were seeing their young people going off to war and dying terrible deaths. They were in dire circumstances at this point, and they were unsure of what their future held. They were unsure of God's power as well, because it appeared to them as though the God of the other nation was beating their God. Try to picture it. The battle was raging to the north of Jerusalem. The people had gathered on Mount Zion in Jerusalem. They can almost see the battle to the north from the top of their mountain. Their young people are dying. The northern kingdom has already fallen to the Assyrians. They fear that before long they're going to be next. To make matters worse, they're running out of food, they're running out of provisions, and they're surrounded. And as they gather to worship in their time, the prophet Isaiah stands up in their midst in that situation and says, "On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, 'Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we've waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation.'" How on earth could Isaiah say these kind of words, knowing that war was just outside of their gates? How could he say, "On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food"? They wouldn't want to share that feast with the Assyrians. They were attacking them. They were terrible people, the Assyrians. They would not want to share the feast with their enemies. And yet the thought of God preparing a banquet cannot help but remind them of Psalm 23. "You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows." As Isaiah finishes his word to them, he continues talking about all people, not just about them. How God will help all people. How one day God will swallow up death and God himself will wipe away the tears from their eyes. God cares. And God knows that in the wars, innocent people die on both sides. God has seen all of their tears and their mourning, and we bring them from mourning to happiness. That's their hope and our hope as well. Psalm 23 reminds us that God does not leave us in the dark valleys of life, that God walks with us through the valleys and brings us to the other side, to a great banquet. On this Remembrance Day, we mourn with those who mourn as we share a common sorrow. We give thanks with those who give thanks as we share a common affection. And we share a common hope that one day there will be peace, that we will be inspired to work towards that peace, and that one day death itself will be swallowed up and God will wipe away every tear from our eyes and be reunited with that great cloud of witnesses who have gone before us. And there will be a great banquet. In Jesus' name we give thanks, and in hope we look to the future. Amen. Let's remain seated now and listen to the Ministry of Music. You'll remember from last year, we included more of the pictures of people from connected with our congregation who served in the wars, and we'll be able to share those pictures again.
In my heart, sequestered chambers, thy truth stripped of poet's gloss, words alone are veiled vacant, and my heart is mute.
In response to aching silence, memory summons half-heard voices,
and my soul finds primal eloquence
and wraps me in song.
We've been richly blessed in this life. One of the ways we give thanks to God is through our tithes and offerings, and Marlene will now bring forward the offering plate. I invite you to stand and sing quietly to yourself the doxology. Gracious God, we thank you for these gifts shared today. We thank you for these pieces of paper and metal that become tangible expressions of your love and care here in this community and around the world. May they be used, O God, to serve you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. On this Remembrance Sunday, O God, we have many things to bring to you in prayer. We pray especially for those who lost loved ones in the wars and in service since then. We pray for comfort and peace for those who are remembering and for whom the memories bring back terror and shock as well. Bring comfort and peace, O God, for family members as well. Remembering as well the hardships that people went through being at home through the wars. Pray as these memories come up, O God, that they would stimulate us to work towards a more peaceful future. Watch over each and every one of us, O God. Bring healing where healing is needed. Bring peace where peace is needed. And when we can't bring our prayers to you with words, when we fear that words are going to be wrapped in tears, when we know the deepest longings of our hearts can't be put into words, we come to you in silence, also knowing that you hear those prayers. And so in silence we pray and we listen. I invite you to stand as again we mumble together our closing hymn, O Day of Peace That Dimly Shines, number 732 if you have a hymn book at home.
Just to prove that love.
We go from this place and the world that surrounds us with a common sorrow, with a common affection, with a common hope. We go with God's peace. Now may the grace, the mercy, and peace of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with us this day and every day. Amen. A reminder that you are welcome to stay. So make your doors onto the church lawn when you feel ready. Go now in peace.